So welcome, everyone, to this day of conversation devoted to Constable's correspondence and to the wide epistolary, artistic, cultural, social, and political worlds to which that correspondence can be productively related. My name's Mark Hallett. I'm the director here at the PMC. I'm delighted, so delighted, to welcome so many of you to what promises to be a wonderful event. I can't tell you how fantastic it is to see a packed lecture room here at the PMC. And also, I'm so pleased to say that this event is also being live-streamed to an international online audience and recorded for later release. So we have a fantastic array of speakers and talks lined up for today, and a great audience who will, I'm sure, be full of questions and discussion around those papers. But I guess, in some ways, although this event relates or emerges out of a number of contexts, I think three are crucial. First of all, it emerges out of the broader generation landscape research project that I've been leading at the centre over the past few years. It's been devoted to pursuing new research on the remarkable cohort of landscape artists, including figures such as Turner, Topman, Girton, of course, Constable himself, who exploded into prominence in the 1790s, who so profoundly reshaped the conventions and ambitions of British landscape art in a variety of media. And indeed, this conference follows on from last November's Graphic Landscape Conference, which I co-convened with Felicity Myrone, again under the auspices of the PMC's research project. And that, you'll remember, was devoted to the landscape print series that proliferated in the late 18th and early 19th centuries. And it is interesting in this respect that so many of today's papers will focus on Constable's collaborations with David Lucas on their own great print series, English Landscape Scenery. It's clearly a focus of a lot of interesting scholarly work at the moment. So if the Generation Landscape Project provides one context for today, another is the long-running conversations that have been taking place amongst many of us about the possibility of generating an online edition of Constable's correspondence, or at least that of Ronald Beckett's great edition of that correspondence, which the centre's predecessor, the Paul Mellon Foundation, played such a large part in funding. It's worth remembering. Those ongoing conversations in focusing our attention on the correspondence have only made us ever more aware of its continuing richness and interest and potential for all scholars of early 19th century British culture. But thirdly and finally, and I think probably most importantly, today's event owes a great deal to my co-convener, Steve Daniels. It was Steve, a few years ago, approached me with a suggestion that we might work together on a project devoted to Constable's correspondence. It was Steve who alerted me to all the work that was being carried out on the letters outside the world of art history, particularly by scholars like Trev Bratton. It's fantastic that, Trev, you're here with us today. And it was Steve, and I'm sure this is true, who came up with the simple but brilliant idea that this project, which he initially thought of as a book project, and we'll be interested to see where this goes, and we'll want to take it further, might centre upon the exercise of subjecting individual letters to or from Constable to a close reading, and to use these letters to open out and explore broader questions, including those we used to head our call for papers. Questions such as, how do artists' letters articulate professional and personal affiliations, or embody networks and forge allegiances? What role has letter writing played in artistic self-fashioning? In what ways do letters serve as a form of art historical evidence and help us understand works of art themselves? So the fact that we're all gathered together today, and people have travelled from across the world to be with us today, and that we can look forward to such a rich series of papers and to so much stimulating discussion, is in large part thanks to the person I'd now like to ask to come to the lecture and provide our introduction, Steve Daniels. Someone, as you all know, has not only been transforming the field of geography for many decades, but has also, over that same period, been one of our most brilliant thinkers about Constable and his art and about Georgian visual culture more generally. Can I ask you all to give him the warmest of welcomes? Thanks very much indeed.
Thank you, Mark, for that generous introduction, and thank you all for coming today. As Mark said, what we propose to do is to reopen Constable's correspondence to address these major questions. And the letters we're going to hear about today are less well known than a lot of those that have been published, and some have come to light after Beckett's great edition of the correspondence. And we're going to hear about accounts of the painter which are less familiar, on portraiture, on life drawing, on his studio in London, on Sussex scenes, and as we heard, in the swing of the centre of gravity on Constable studies towards the last decade of his life, the 1830s, so-called late Constable. Before Beckett's great collection, a selection of Constable's letters had long been publicly available, particularly in the many editions of the memoirs of the life of John Constable by his friend, Charles Leslie, first published in 1843. And the book is largely composed of Constable's correspondence, particularly with Leslie himself. Indeed, for much of the 19th century, Constables were better known to the public than his pictures. Some of the letters that Leslie published have become canonical texts in views of Constable's art. Although, as subsequent critics were keen to demonstrate, Leslie's selection, abridgment, quotation, and editing presented a particular, politely Victorian view of the artist: domestic, amiable, familiar, sentimental, settled. When Beckett first published a selection of the letters from the correspondence to John Fisher in 1952, it revealed a rather different Constable, more rancorous, ambitious, contentious, more combative, whose letters shift register from high-minded pronouncements on art and life to a somewhat salacious humour. Does your wife see any letters? Fisher asks nervously at one point. And he asks for some to be burned, which evidently were not, otherwise we wouldn't know that he did ask them to be burned. And there's a third party in this correspondence, as some of you will know. That is John Bull. That is the title of the magazine of that time, a loyalist Church and King journal that Fisher was keen to publish some of Constable's remarks in. So it's part of that often rancorously reactionary sentiment, and it's rather like the letters between Kingsley Amis, who you can kind of ratcheting up the right-wing register between Philip Larkin and Kingsley Amis. Beckett's publication of the Constable Fisher record of a friendship is significant for a long preface by the writer and critic Geoffrey Grigson, who emphasized its contrast to Leslie's sentimental interpretation. Here was unexpurgated Constable, his manliness, bold, vigorous, combative. And it's interesting, it comes with a shift in Constable country. In the preface to the collection, there was a map of the correspondence networks stretching from Abingdon on the Thames Valley to Weymouth on the coast, titled Map of Wessex. And that same year, Grigson issued a guidebook on Wessex in the Festival of Britain series, in which Wessex is singled out as being the primal heart of England. So it's interesting that the imaginative geographies of Constable can shift with the kind of correspondence that we read. And Beckett's multi-volume edition of correspondence, published in the 1960s, I think deserves its own social history of collection and co-production, published with the Suffolk Record Society, with significant funding from the Paul Mellon Foundation for British Art. And the society was founded by the historian Norman Scarfe, who worked with W.G. Hoskins in the University of Leicester. And so you have two retired scholars. You have Scarfe, who's retired from Leicester to his native Suffolk, founding the society, and Beckett, a fascinating figure, who wanted to be an art historian but spent 40 years in the colonial civil service as a judge and magistrate in the Punjab. The first volume of the Beckett correspondence on his family in East Bergholt repatriated Grigson's Wessex man to the domestic circle in his native home. And a new edition was published just before the great Tate Bicentenary exhibition of 1976. And this exhibition, the landmark exhibition, drew extensively on the correspondence and on the lecture texts in the discourses, not just for documenting Constable's life, but for complicating the relation between Constable's words and pictures, his ideas and his images. And in a catalogue essay, Connell Shields drew attention to the problem of conceptualization, which Constable condensed into his maxims, which previous commentators, including Leslie, had really passed over. For example, Shields singles out, the art of seeing nature is a thing almost to be acquired as the art of reading the Egyptian hieroglyphics. And Shields says that, well, really a starting point here should be the discovery and decipherment of the Rosetta Stone, which was one of the spoils of the Napoleonic Wars. As well as Constable's paintings and drawings, the exhibition displayed manuscript specimens of the artist's writing, a letter, notes to lectures, and an extensively corrected proof from the English landscape scenery, his collaboration with David Lucas. And in the wealth of Constable's studies in the wake of the exhibition, scholars have focused on the meaning and the production of meaning in the letters and the lectures, including Michael Rosenthal in his landmark book of 1983, and Anne Birmingham in her 1987 article in Art History, Reading Constable, in which she draws attendance to the rhetoric of the correspondence, its literary sources, ideological assumptions, its claims for posterity, its changing registers, and what she calls the fractures in Constable's epistolary style. More recently, Trev Broughton, who is here today as discussant, has addressed the tropes, themes, and self-fashioning in matters of business and pleasure, and the relation to other literary forms of the time, like novels and conduct literature, as well as conversational idioms like gossip and banter. And she's also noted how conscious Constable was of published letters as literary form. So, for example, a recently published edition of the letters of Nicolas Poussin, which Maria read to him, his wife translating from the French as he painted in Brighton, and the letters of the poet William Cooper, a new edition of which Constable was reading in bed on the night that he unexpectedly died. And Trev also draws attention to the time and the place of letter writing, often at the end of the day for Constable when he's hurrying with the postman's bell ringing for the collection and his handwriting deteriorating into a scrawl. And also, a number of letters are written by the window of particular views. There's a fascinating one to Maria from Wivenhoe, which is picked out in the painting, in which he says he's looking over Colchester on a beautiful evening. In another, he tells Maria he was met by his brother, Abram, coming 12 miles from Flatford, picking him up in his sports car, that is, his gig, his two-wheeled carriage, which he assured me would not have been the case had I not sent him a note, a hasty note from the Hampstead stage, which is illustrated on the headline slide. He thinks it cost him about a penny for each word. So that's three pennies, three words. And that was a significant sum. And in one letter, he writes to Maria, just a few lines, I'm so hurried, I shall write to you again tomorrow. He's putting off a visit to her. He said, I shall ruin you with postage. The speed of the mail in Constable's correspondence before the railways and the penny post seems remarkable. And one of the most famous letters to Fisher about the sky as the organ of sentiment has Fisher reading it over breakfast as it has come overnight rather than his newspaper. Glad to see your writing so clear and smooth, a certain proof of tranquil mind. And tranquility was a major ecclesiastical virtue for Fisher. Fisher referred to the tranquility of the cathedral. Your letter lay here on the table, Fisher tells him, part of the table talk he was having with a judge who came, and they're discussing the merits of Constable's pictures. And one of the most intimate letters to Fisher indicates how compressed the 100 miles between Hampstead and Salisbury could be. So he's looking out from the West Heath, and Constable sketches a panorama, and he picks out Windsor Castle. And Windsor Castle is in the Diocese of Salisbury. And Fisher ministered there. So it's a kind of relay station into Salisbury itself. rather like the shutter telegraph, which was happening at the same time. So widely circulated have been transcriptions of Constable's letters that we can lose sight, and finally I'll show today, of the originals. And I just want to show a couple of examples, and this is probably the best known. It's inserted into a volume of Leslie's memoirs in the Yale Centre for British Art. And it was recently reproduced in a book called Artist Letters, Leonardo da Vinci to David Hockney. And the letter appears next to a picture postcard from Cindy Sherman. It's an early letter, 1794, the young constable studying for his career, writing to John Thomas Smith. It's one of a series to the then drawing master and topographical author living in Edmonton. And the final page of the letter, which is shown here, has a paragraph on Constable's anxiety. He regrets a sentence he's written to Smith. And Smith replies, and Constable is very nervous because Smith hasn't used half of the paper. So he thinks he's cross with him. And so he tries to placate Smith, and one of the ways that he does it is by this view from my window of the house in East Burgold of the family's picturesquely thatched barn. And on the opening page, he calls him Friend Smith, drawing him into the family and friendship circle. And the bearer of the letter to Smith, he says, is a native of our village and my shoemaker. Perhaps he's never been from 20 miles from home before. So, all, you know, these questions about the penmanship, about the infrastructure of the exchange. The second example is from late in Constable's career in 1832. It's a note to the young engraver, David Lucas, during the production of English landscape scenery. And this is from a book of letters collected by Leslie, now in the National Art Library at the V&A. So one of the things is an interesting issue is the way that the particular letters were collected. These have been rather too well stuck down in the album. But neither Leslie's brief extract in his memoirs from this letter, nor Beckett's published transcription, convey the performative force and urgency of the message. It's been sent from Constable's studio in Charlotte Street. It's timed 7:30 in the morning to await a reply from Lucas's house in Paddington. And it's one of a series of often lively, sometimes frenetic exchanges of notes, packets of proofs, and visits. And this note was perhaps carried by Leslie, who lived in Marylebone, rather than Constable's usual messenger, Mr. Pitt. So there's kind of often a triangular traffic going between Leslie, Lucas, and Constable, which is perhaps why Leslie kept it. And this one has been written on a circular by a Brighton pharmacist. Constable was there in July. His daughter was very ill. And Constable has crossed out the list of wares on it, from soda water to self-injecting syringes. And the circular was clearly on hand, as Constable was in a hurry. But it reminds us how the publication of English landscape scenery was transected by issues and texts on trade and advertising. And while the words are dashed off, they are very carefully weighed and resonant, and they resonate with some of the papers that we're going to hear today. At this fraught time of deaths and maladies, the death of Fisher recently, and illnesses, including Constable's own, his rheumatism making it painful to write. Constable had touched a proof mezzotint that Lucas had spoiled to convert a church tower into a ruined abbey. He says at the top, "I have added ruin to the little glebe farm," and continuing with his customary black humour, "for not to have a symbol in the book of myself and of the work which I have projected would be missing an opportunity. And at the bottom of the page, Constable Mole's titles to mezzotints should a barge be either passing, going through, or shooting a log. He settles for passing, but he's weighing these words incredibly carefully. 5 days later, Constable wrote Lucas a longer, more proper-looking letter from Hampstead by a so-called fly letter by express mail, in which he says he will author a letterpress to each print. Descriptions, quotations, poetic display, and principles of art, and as much moral feeling as possible. Thank you, and I will now introduce our first two speakers. I'd like to welcome first up Alexandra Harris from the University of Birmingham. Alexandra was part of the Landscape Now event that we had here, and also the Late Constable exhibition, Annie Lyle's exhibition at Marvellous Show at the Royal Academy. But I want to pick out, which is not mentioned on her bio, but her book Weatherland, which has a fascinating section on Constable, in which she's able to decode the meaning of some of the key terms, including organ of sentiment, that have been used so freely in Constable's correspondence. And that's a much wider book about weather and climate and landscape. And Alexandra's going to be talking today to the title New Friends, New Scenes, Constable in the Arun Valley.
Thank you so much for having me here. I've been thinking a good deal lately about local sources, local history, and the way that the kinds of imaginative geographies, as Stephen so brilliantly puts it, that emanate from books very particular to certain places, how those come together with the more canonical histories of art and literature. So for me, there was something very special about Constable's letters in that they appeared in the Suffolk Record Society series, which in the Bodleian anyway is filed under topography. It's a different section to art history, and there they are amongst the Ipswich merchants' diaries and the Bury St. Edmunds cartularies. And that colliding of different kinds of source, seeing Constable as a local writer, is very intriguing to me. And the area that I've been looking most at is Sussex. So the Sussex Record Society has been my great source for the last few years. And so I wanted to take us down to Arundel, where Constable goes on a kind of holiday. So I'm going to take us on a sort of holiday, and we're going to look at a wish you were here letter, though of a rather special kind. And we're equipped, our props for the trip are a Constable and Sons stoneware flagon and a beer bottle, because we are going to meet a brewer down on the River Arun in West Sussex, a port town, a rural town, a historic town in a valley of water meadows, which is and is not like the water meadow country of the Stour. Leslie, the recipient, will be, of course, important as we think about this letter, but we're also going to have another major figure in it, George Constable of Arundel. And I guess I'm going to try and tell a sort of microbiography, micro art history emanating from one moment in time, July 1834, John Constable sitting in the drawing room at George Constable's house. And with hindsight about George Constable, we might have a strange light cast over the letter, but we shall get there. So let's just start off on this letter. My dear Leslie, in all my walks about this beautiful spot, I am continually thinking of you. How much your company would enhance the beautiful things which are continually crossing my path. John is enjoying himself exceedingly. The chalk cliffs afford him many a fragment of oyster shells and other matters that fell from the table of Adam, in all probability. But our friend here, Mr. George Constable, is a most sensible man in all matters of science, and he has won John's heart by a present, the arrival of which in Charlotte Street I shall much dread of an electrifying machine. Well, we've got many a vivid image there, the electrifying machine. In fact, now, when Cooper, John Cooper was in Sussex, very close to Arundel, he was also given an electrifying machine to help Mrs. Unwin after her stroke. So they are very much around and about at this time. But the fondness between the two constables, no relation, had arisen really in a family context, in that both had sons of about the same age who were interested in fossils, and George Constable was sending fossils to young John Constable and encouraging his interest in science and geology. So what a lot of friends who are parents say is, I'm happy when my children are happy. And I think that's at the root of this trip that John Constable takes down to Arundel. Just before we take this off the screen, I'll come back to some elements of it, but this sense of, in all my walks, I'm continually thinking of you, stays with me so much. What is it that Leslie would see and show him? What is it that Constable could express to Leslie about this place that is so different from what he gets from George Constable, the amateur painter, keen collector, local man? Those are very different kinds of seeing and different kinds of knowledge. And there's clearly, for John Constable, a sense that to be with Charles Leslie would be to see this landscape with a more painterly eye, I suspect, that they would together work out the meaning of beauty in this place in a slightly different way to what he can do with the local brewer. that picture's all right, that's good. George Constable he'd admired English landscape scenery, he'd met John Constable in London, and the invitation down to Sussex came after John Constable's illness, and he had written, I sincerely wish I could prevail on you to take a trip to Arundel. I'm sure you would derive great benefit from it. And there is, I'm using the Yeakel and Gardner 1783 map of Sussex because it's so beautiful. So I know I'm 40 years out, but it does give you a sense of the relief topography of the Downs, the line of the Downs. Arundel situated just on the south side of the Downs, and the Arun cutting, the way the Arun cuts through the high ground of the chalk. At the top, the way that you can, and Gardner do their shading, shows you the scarp slope of the Downs. So to the north of the Downs, you get the really rugged, important word for Constable, rugged scenery on that side, and then the dip slope on the southern side, which I think is going to correspond a little bit more to Constable's notion of beauty in that smooth dip slope. And at this time, it's a busy port city, a busy port town. So it's both rural, but also full of working lives. And I want just here to add in an extra comment about, well, we've got this George Constable on the letter on the screen, just to say how interesting I find it that Beckett chose to group the amateur artists together in his volume 5 of his series of letters, and he clearly did so because he was so struck by the pattern of Constable's friendships with amateur artists, his respect for them, the freedom he felt in talking with amateur artists about art. But of course, lots of people have brought out this grey area between amateur and professional. George Constable, he's a professional brewer. He is never going to be called a professional artist. But there's something that is very, I think, freeing for John Constable about making this new friendship with a man so enthused about painting landscape, but not in any sense a serious London competitor. Now, so the son, John, went ahead, and here's what you encounter coming into Arundel. This is a little bit of a wetter, this is a wetter scene than you might have in mid-July. I always seem to be there in the winter when the water meadows are indeed watery. I just wanted to put up an image that shows you this mix of really... of the rural, of the downland, of the water meadow, the way that hilly hangers meet water in such contiguity, and the castle, which Constable is going to try and work out what he thinks of. Here also, more scene setting. The big ships could come up the river to Arundel at this time. They can't now. But it was a customs port alongside Littlehampton. So lots of shipping would come right up into Arundel, and you get the warehouses all along the river. And there is George Constable's brewery. That's from 1880. I cannot find an image of how it was in 1834, but it was clearly a big enterprise, and it was on the same site on Queen Street, going into the town over the river, and between them, this party gathered for 10 days in the summer, go off from this centre, touring first to Bignor. I wonder why they went first to Bignor, and I suspect it might be because Constable knew about it from Charlotte Smith's elegiac sonnets, which is not something I'm going to talk about today, but could be a big area of study. They went fossil hunting. This was the main event, and the chalk of Sussex is jolly good for finding those oysters that fell from the table of Adam, in all probability. I find the phrase so striking. I think it's one of the most vivid and surreal in all of Constable's correspondence so far as I've read it. And it means that when I walk through Offham hangers now, I actually have this image of this sort of giant Adam sitting at a table on the down. And to think of Constable having in his mind this sort of domestic scene of Edenic oyster slurping, and for his host, George Constable, to have had completely other scenes in his mind, because if you were interested in geology in Sussex at this time, you were reading Gideon Mantell, whose Fossils of the South Downs came out in 1822, followed by a sequence of Geology of the Southeast books in the 1830s. That was the news of the moment. Another interesting geologist with a very local focus on this area, Dr. Peter Martin, based in Pulborough, he'd published his geological memoir. He was trying to work out how the whole area had been formed in cataclysm and so on. So these people were imagining the warm tropical seas of Sussex and oysters falling through millions of years to form chalk. And Constable is imagining Adam at his table. And he's thinking about the stories that time-mangled matter might tell. This time-mangled matter, he writes to Constable in an earlier letter, a phrase I think taken from Othello, I might be corrected there, but the mangled matter of a story taken from Shakespeare. And it makes me wonder what the the oysters that fell from the table of Adam, in all probability, But our friend here, Mr. George Constable, is a most sensible man in all matters of science. I just wonder about the implication of that but. Is he positioning his Adam against George Constable's science and the geology? Or is it a sort of throat-clearing but? Right. Constable starts drawing. He needs to get a sense of the relationship of the castle to the town. As he's going to say, the castle here is the chief ornament of this place, but all here sinks to insignificance in comparison with the woods and hills. The woods hang from excessive steeps and precipices, and the trees are beyond everything beautiful. I never saw such beauty in natural landscape before. I wish it may influence what I may do in future, for I have too much preferred the picturesque to the beautiful, which I hope may account for the broken ruggedness of my style. A phrase much quoted and to me quite perplexing, this distinction he's drawing between the picturesque and the beautiful and the rugged in his style, and how he thinks that this landscape, which is, I think, both beautiful and picturesque altogether, might change that. He goes on from thinking about those steep hangers and excessive precipices to the flatlands of the meadows. The meadows are lovely, so is the delightful river, and the old houses are rich beyond all things of the sort, but the trees above all, but anything is beautiful. Only last night I stumbled on an old barn situated amid trees of immense size like this, and I'm just so sure, the picture of the barn was cut out by Leslie and bound into one of the Grangerized copies of his memoirs. And I believe it's the one which was in the PMC collection, is now at the British Museum, but I'm just going to wait to be absolutely corrected, and I will do the rest of my homework after the conference. For my purposes, I'm just wrapped by this idea of John Constable going out in the evening, last night, in a summer dusk, away from all of that hubbub of these two big families, and wandering amid these ancient barns and being drawn to these buildings. This relationship of the natural to the built environment, which is something you're so aware of around Arundel, where you really do bump into these barns. He adds that it's from the time of King John. And I wonder whether that's a kind of impressionistic guess, or whether it relates to the fact that George Constable really was reading his antiquities. I'm going to say a little bit more about that before I end. But I want to take us into this is I want to take us into the house. Again, I'm worried that I'm going to be corrected within 30 seconds, but the house was, George Constable's house was traditionally identified as Sefton House on Arundel High Street, but I believe it's not, than that it's this house on Maltravers Street, and a very fine, prosperous merchant's house it is too. At that time, it wouldn't have had those projecting bays, so you get a flat-fronted, good late Georgian townhouse. And if we go inside, this is not the inside. This is what the Jeffrey Museum think we might find inside in 1830s. That's why I've put it in half faded. You know, this sort of thing. So here's Constable writing, and I love this sense that we can feel him writing in George Constable's drawing room. In the drawing room in which I am now writing, he says to Leslie, are many enormous pieces of stained paper by Copley Fielding, as well as of poor Robson and Hovell, and some oils by William Daniel. Therefore, I hope you'll excuse whatever this letter may contain. Well, frankly, this is why I chose this letter. It's just so waspish and mean and funny. And it was cut out, of course, by Leslie, who wouldn't have wanted to publish such an offensive judgment on Constable's fellow artists. But this sense of the kind of in-joke between Constable and Leslie, knowing that they might feel the same things about these enormous pieces of stained paper produced by the old Watercolour Society people. I found you some examples. I don't know which ones George Constable has. Somebody in the room probably knows which enormous pieces of stained paper were on George Constable's walls. But Copley Fielding had done a lot of work around Arundel very, very recently, and it's quite possible that they met. Copley Fielding takes the elevated vantage point from the Noble Park, does the very highly worked exhibition view. Fennel Robson, he just died. So that poor Fennel Robson, he's set slightly apart from the criticism of the other items in George Constable's collection. Leslie had been hosting... Leslie had been hosted just before he left for America by Fennel Robson. Just the August before, August 33, Fennel Robson hosts at home a goodbye party for Leslie and then is dead within 2 weeks. So that's why we get that poor, poor Robson. And then as for those oils, I've just given you some examples of what William Daniel did with Arundel. And one can see immediately how Constable might be wanting to do something very different, but also how the ways of painting Arundel had become so fixed. You know, you did the giant castle with its noble baronial elevations, and you did that big view from high up on the down, looking over the parkland to the sea. And so straight away, Constable is off doing old farmhouses at Halton. And lots and lots of scratching out, this textural rebellion from those big polished views of Arundel. He doesn't really do the chalk. The chalk in the background there is Amberley chalk pits, which is a truly dramatic environment, just blazing under the sun because of that white. The white powder gets everywhere. I'm intrigued that Constable chooses those rich buildings, rich beyond all things of their kind, and the geology is their setting for those working lives, as it is for the Fittleworth Mill. I'm actually not going to talk about... Oh, sorry. I'm not going to talk about the forgeries. We can do that in the questions. But I'm going to end with something that I realised quite late in making this talk. So Constable comes back again to stay with George Constable in Arundel the following year, and settles down beside Swanbourne Lake, which is just beyond the castle, part of the castle park, and makes the drawing which he will use when he starts his big oil Arundel mill and castle. I think that there's a combination of interests and forms of local knowledge that start to come together for him that's very intriguing. And one of those forms of knowledge comes through George Constable the brewer, who introduces him to Mark Tierney, the antiquary, who in 1834, this is the key year, had just published his 2-volume, very antiquarian, History of Arundel, which is mainly full of working out the pedigrees of the Dukes of Norfolk, about which Constable is slightly sceptical. Arundel is very much a Catholic town, and there may well be some tension in ideological thinking there. But as he gets to the end of his book, a book which Constable asked to borrow, he asked to meet Tierney, he was interested in, Tierney moves away from the tracing of dukes, and he traces the history of the mills of Arundel. And he ends by saying that the only surviving one of four previous Swanbourne mills is the one which was mentioned in the Doomsday Book. And he says that to sit by Swanbourne Lake and to watch the mill is a thing of beauty beyond all beauties of Arundel. He says, the steep acclivities on each hand, clothed with luxuriant forest trees or exposing the wild and rugged surface of the rock, these, with the stillness of the place, present a scene with which the feelings of the heart will readily unite, and the mind hastening back to the age of the confessor will fancy itself beside the mill which was at work nearly 800 years ago. So it seems to me that Constable alights on this world of local thinking about industrial and working history and how that might go back to King John or the Confessor, and he sort of empties it out of the textbook history, but keeps and distills this sense of how 800 years might be present in the moment sitting by Swanbourne Mill. And I think that some of that is coming through from George Constable, the brewer, and that we start to see it in that letter to Leslie, where he's mediating between two kinds of influence, the professional artist and this local man who can introduce into other kinds of local knowledge. And that's where I shall end. Thank you.
Thank you. Wonderful beginning for us. I'd now like to welcome Amy Concannon, who is Mountain Senior Curator in Historic British Art at Tate, and she's curated major exhibitions on Turner and Blake, and her Nottingham PhD thesis used Constable as a starting point to explore a much wider visual culture of urban landscape, so a new urban Constable. In various cities and towns around Britain. But she's returning to an early love of hers. She worked for the Wordsworth Trust and is still a trustee and is going to speak to us on strengthening ties and gaining esteem. Constable writes to Wordsworth, 15th of June, 1836. Amy.
Indeed, I did work at the Wordsworth Trust. And actually, the letter that I'm going to talk about today, I spent literally hours, if not days, with, because one of my first tasks was to invigilate a Constable exhibition that Tim Wilcox here had been involved in. And so I spent hours looking at this letter inside the case, but it's actually quite nice to come back to it and think about it properly. Thank you very much for having me as part of the day. This is one of those letters that doesn't feature in the Beckett edition of correspondence. It was discovered too late for its inclusion, and it was discovered at auction, turning up in 1977 in a group of Wordsworth family papers, which then were purchased by Dove Cottage, the Wordsworth Trust. I've also got a slightly pixelated middle image, but it's there for illustration. Written on the 15th of June, 1836, less than a year before Constable's death, it's the last in a series of markers of his admiration for William Wordsworth. It's also the first of a trail of evidence that indicates that, to some degree, this admiration was mutual. It was sent precisely 30 years after the men first met, and it offers chance to reflect on how Constable mobilised the art of letter writing, as well as his professional outputs, in this case, English landscape scenery, which is going to come up time and time again today, and the series of lectures on landscape that he gave. He uses the art of letter writing and these two professional outputs as tools in a strategy, I think, to underline and cultivate connections and ultimately prove his worthiness. The personal and intellectual common ground between Constable and Wordsworth, pillars of British Romanticism, whose regional affiliations between Suffolk, Dedham, the Lake District, particularly Grasmere, became enshrined in their professional outputs and public personas. These connections may seem very obvious to us now, and there has been lots of work done on those connections. There won't be time to delve very deeply into those connections. But it's that connection seems something that Constable is at pains to convey to Wordsworth in this letter. So although it's short, it opens up a very rich story. I'm going to talk through its cast of characters, both human and inanimate. There's Constable's manifesto for landscape art, English landscape scenery, Sir George Beaumont, Reverend Thomas Judkin, one of these amateur artists that we've already heard about, and then, of course, Wordsworth. I chose this portrait. I'm not going to use it again. It's a bit later, but I like the way he's looking down on Constable. But first, though, I want to address the limitation of the transcription. So much, if not all, of the literature about Constable utilises his letters. They're a wealth of information, and they contain so many reflections and accounts to draw on, a veritable goldmine for all of us. But so few of the books and articles, as been mentioned already today, so few of those texts actually reproduce those letters. And I hazard, so few of the scholars that use them have seen the documents in the flesh to which they refer. I count myself in this number. So we rely on those transcriptions. But part of the reason that we're here today is because those transcriptions do have their limitations. For me, as an art historian, coming from a background of working very closely with a manuscript collection in my first job, and possessing, as a consequence, a very nerdy fascination for paper, not being able to see that letter is often frustrating. A letter, as my old boss, Jeff Cowton of the Wordsworth Trust, has written, a letter is the representation of words, images, and ideas in a form that itself has history and meaning. It's one that holds clues to its creation and history. And I think that's important, particularly when we're considering the sentiment and the context in which these letters, these pieces of paper, were created. So thinking about this letter as a piece of paper, what clues to its creation and its history does it give? Well, it's good quality writing paper, of the kind that Constable sometimes made drawings on. It's folded in half, and it's used on both sides, covering all of the sheet. So there's no possible accusations that Constable was issuing a slight. He's used all the paper, with a front, an inner, and then a back page. It was cut down from a larger sheet, as can be seen from the torn edge at the bottom. And the papermaker, a watermark hints at this, was Grosvenor Chater & Co., manufactured most likely in a North East Wales paper mill and bought by Constable in London. Folded, it measures just smaller than modern A5. He writes in brown ink, now quite faded, but he hasn't folded it as Constable might a regular letter. He simply folded it into thirds and then written Wordsworth's name on the outer face. This letter didn't need a seal, for it was to be enclosed in a parcel containing a gift, a copy of Constable's English landscape scenery. I've included here a couple of letters for comparison that were folded in the standard way where the paper itself becomes its own envelope. You fold it back on itself and then seal it. Incidentally, these ones are sealed with black wax, signifying a period of mourning, most likely. And I did have a thing about, I took it out because of time, about the handwriting. The handwriting here is less legible than that in this letter, and I think that plays into the idea that Constable's in a more stable frame of mind, certainly wants to present himself as such, and impressions mattered. He was writing to the most famous poet of the day. He really wanted to make a good impression. I'm going to read that letter. My dear sir, may I beg as a mark of my sincere esteem that you will do me the honour to accept my little work on the chiaroscuro, the subjects of which are for the most part in the neighbourhood of Dedham, in Essex, one of the early and favourite haunts of our valued friend, the late Sir George Beaumont, whom my mother knew a little boy. I feel that I am indebted to him for what I am as an artist, and it was from his hands that I first saw a volume of your poems. How then can I be ever, however, can I ever be sufficiently grateful? My little work occupied me during a season of sadness, occasioned by the loss of the mother of my 7 children. I heard from Mr. Judkin of your intended tour. I wish you every happy result from it. I shall always reflect with pride that you was at one of my lectures. My last is tomorrow, but I fear I must not again flatter myself with the hope of seeing you there. I am, my dear sir, most truly your faithful and obliged, John Constable. The tone of this letter is, I think, buoyant with a hint of anxious energy. Constable was on something of a roll, professionally speaking. He'd been made an RA, a member of the Royal Academy in 1829, though his admittance to that professional inner sanctum didn't prove to be a fix-all for his professional woes. The gift he gives to Wordsworth, English landscape scenery, and the lecture mentioned in the letter that Wordsworth attended were ways that Constable channeled his determination to be taken seriously, but also to reinforce the interdisciplinary intellectualism of landscape as a genre, as something that was both, in his words, scientific but also poetic. Constable's lectures took place on Thursdays in May and June 1836. The one that Wordsworth attended was held at the Royal Institution, just off Piccadilly. It was dedicated to the landscape of the Dutch and Flemish schools. Constable arranged this slot with scientist Michael Faraday and sent out invitations, so Wordsworth was therefore prompted to attend. But there were also adverts placed in the press. Constable doesn't appear to have been offered a fee to speak, to give these lectures, unlike most Royal Institution lecturers. But of course, the value to Constable was that platform, the opportunity to consolidate his professional standing, cultivate respect from his peers, widen his connections, and to speak about landscape art, symbolically, in a building dedicated to science, thereby underlining his thesis that there was a science to the understanding of landscape art and to the production of great landscape paintings. This is, again, it's a bit later, the image, but that's Michael Faraday giving a lecture to a packed lecture hall. I don't know how packed Wordsworth's lectures, Constable's lectures were, but the desk that Faraday stands at, that was his desk and is still used today in the Christmas lectures. So I like the idea that Constable himself also used that desk. The letter can be seen alongside English landscape scenery and the lectures as part of that broader project to bolster Constable's standing and to look to posterity. The passing of time and life itself had been marked by the passing of significant people. Most significant, of course, was Maria, who died in 1828, but also his mentor, George Beaumont, mentioned here, in 1827. Constable's friend and greatest confidant, John Fisher, died suddenly in 1832, as did Constable's studio assistant, John Dunthorne, who was the son of an old friend. So while the letter has two ostensible purposes, to express thanks to Wordsworth for attending his lecture, which he does so effusively, being honoured, flattered, and delighted that the poet was there, and to enclose a gift, that's the second purpose, these acts point towards a deeper purpose. I need not rely on the social theories of gift giving to point out that the copy of English landscape scenery was sent as a material investment in this relationship, motivated by a sense of urgency to capitalise on Wordsworth's interest in him, a desire to make, remake, and deepen connections against a background threat marked by the passing of people close to him that life was short. But Constable could not, of course, know that time was running out and that he would die within a year of writing this letter. This letter wasn't the first time that Wordsworth and Constable had interacted, and I'll expand on that shortly, but this letter was sent at the high point of Constable's admiration and engagement with the poet's work. Though he wasn't an uncritical fan of Wordsworth, 10 years before this letter, so in 1826, he'd described one of Wordsworth's poems as being in bad taste, but did admit that it contained some beautiful descriptions of landscape. Constable's references to Wordsworth and his alignment of their practice through quotation, either in private correspondence or in public, in the fly leaves and the print in the letterpress to English Landscape Scenery, intensified in the years running up to the writing of this letter, dated 1836. Wordsworth had played a role, for example, in Constable's deepening interest in rainbows, which featured more and more in his late work. In 1829, Constable made a copy on scrap wrapping paper of Wordsworth's 1807 poem, The Rainbow. Painting and poetry were sister arts, in Constable's view, each with a mission to call to mind something higher than just mere representation. And though no volume of Wordsworth's poems owned by Constable exists, which I find puzzling, Wordsworth, with his focus on place, nature, and introspective feelings, was his natural counterpart. Indeed, both men acknowledged the formative impact of particular landscapes, the valleys of Grasmere up in the Lake District and Dedham down in Suffolk. They acknowledged those landscapes and the power that they'd had on their own creative powers, and they both produced manifestos that centralised autobiography within their practice, Constable in English Landscape Scenery and Wordsworth in The Prelude, which was to be published later, but he'd already got more or less a full draft of it by this point. The poet, like Constable, regarded his art form as a science. And Wordsworth wrote that poetry was the history or science of feelings. So as well as introducing his gift, self-deprecatingly described as my little work, a tactical means to bring to Wordsworth's attention their professional and intellectual alignment, and saying thank you for his attendance at his lecture, Constable seeks to strengthen the connection by playing then another card, reminding Wordsworth of their personal alignment via Sir George Beaumont. Beaumont, our valued friend, according to the letter, is the foundation stone here, the force that brought poet and painter together into one another's orbit in the first place. Constable nods to this by informing Wordsworth that it was from his hands that he first saw a volume of Wordsworth's poems. Beaumont was an amateur painter, influential patron and connoisseur whose collection formed the nucleus of the National Gallery. He was roughly 20 years older than both Wordsworth and Constable. And Constable's biographer, Leslie, called him the leader of taste in the fashionable world. But I actually prefer watercolourist Thomas Hearn's description of Beaumont, which I think comes closer to this sense of his forceful personality. So Hearn called him the supreme dictator on works of art. Both men enjoyed a beneficial link with Beaumont, but they received differing degrees of respect from their patron friend. Though there were costs attached to the relationship in both cases, for Constable, one of these costs was that Beaumont would ask him to prepare canvases for him to paint on and bring him into all sorts of business that Constable didn't really care to be drawn into. But Beaumont positively lionised Wordsworth. Despite on occasion affecting to despise what Beaumont stood for, Wordsworth allowed Beaumont to illustrate a volume of collected poems and dedicated it to him as a, quote, memorial of a friendship, which I reckon amongst the blessings of my life. Now that, the blessings, Beaumont had given various gifts to Wordsworth of significant financial help, you know, renting houses for him to stay in, all kinds of benefits like that, of which Constable didn't really receive to the same degree. But Constable also felt very much indebted to Beaumont, although at the same time felt very much his social inferior. He referred to him in English Landscape Scenery to their first meeting as having entirely influenced his future life, and he reinforces that gratitude in the letter to Wordsworth, saying that he is indebted to him for what I am as an artist. It was Constable's mother who'd introduced Constable and Beaumont, and the reference in this letter to the fact that Constable's mother knew Beaumont as a child, looking at that closely, it's quite extraneous. It's not detail that necessarily needed to be there. But I think I read it as a kind of emphasis that's almost competitive in tone on the hereditary longevity of Constable's association with Beaumont and the strength of their bond. One of Beaumont's most agreeable characteristics was his impulse to connect people for their mutual benefit. He had the resources and the influence to matchmake, and so it was with Constable and Wordsworth. In 1801 or 2, Beaumont had shared with the young Constable Wordsworth and Coleridge's groundbreaking volume Lyrical Ballads, a poetic statement that ordinary people's lives and the incidental beauty of nature could be the stuff of poetry, written in an unpretentious language. It was when Constable went north for his tour of the Lake District in 1806 an experience which he found mostly disagreeable, that he met Wordsworth in person. That first meeting didn't go entirely well, if we're to believe gossip Joseph Farrington's second-hand account. So a constable met Farrington shortly later, and he'd apparently told Farrington, he remarked upon the high opinion Wordsworth entertains of himself. Constable then told Farrington of how Wordsworth had asked a lady at a party to notice the singular formation of his skull. Constable then reported, this is quite ridiculous, Constable then reported that Coleridge had joined in and said Coleridge, Samuel Taylor Coleridge, Wordsworth's friend, collaborator, sometimes thorn in his side, reported that Coleridge had said that this formation of his skull was the effect of intense thinking. But then Farrington observed to Constable that if so, Wordsworth must have thought in his mother's womb. And of course, that little anecdote reflects Farrington's own potential bias and pleasure in his own joke. But nonetheless, Constable's impression and communication of Wordsworth's conceitedness might also reflect his own inferiority complex and perhaps a hint of jealousy that was maybe borne out by their treatment, different treatment by Sir George Beaumont. Through Beaumont, the two met several more times in the preceding years, including in Brighton in 1824. But I venture that both men had at this point, in 1836, the point of writing this letter, 30 years after they first met, at this point I think they had an appetite for nostalgia, for their youth and for their former selves. They'd now matured and any early heat of the first impressions was gone. And in its stead, certainly for Constable, was an opportunity to seal a bond of intellectual and social kinship. Though it's entirely typical of Constable to pour out personal feelings, I think his opening up to Wordsworth in this letter about his personal sorrows, when he talks of English landscape scenery as a salvation during his season of sadness after the death of Maria, is tactical. It's another way to cultivate that friendship, a showing of vulnerability and soul, sort of man to man. Constable references others to emphasise their connections. Mr. Spedding, down in the postscript, in the postscript, is likely to be lawyer Anthony Spedding, business partner of Constable's father-in-law and brother to Wordsworth's childhood friend, John Spedding of Keswick. Since the parcel could, in the end, be conveyed to Wordsworth in London, this again is another extraneous detail, a detail intended to signify that Constable mattered to and could indeed call favours from people that Wordsworth was close to. In the body of the letter, he reports hearing of Wordsworth's impending tour of France and Italy from their mutual associate, Reverend Judkin, who would go on to conduct Constable's funeral service in 1837, and according to Leslie, he conducted this service with tears streaming down his face. But Constable's wife, Maria, described Judkin very wearily as one of your loungers. So again, you can imagine this sort of rotating cast of characters of amateur artists just wanting to hang out with him. Another amateur artist, Judkin, was a sycophant. In 1826, he sent Constable a sonnet equating him with Wordsworth. Constable sent this on, I think he says something like, without comment, straight to Fisher. So Constable withheld his own feelings about this sonnet, but asked Fisher's opinion. Fisher wrote back, I haven't quoted the poetry because it's bad, but Fisher reassured Constable how Judkin's poem was, although it was bad, certainly not in the style of Milton, which was what Judkin had hoped, it was gratifying to show you how persons think of you. You are secure of both present and future fame, but never of popularity. Few men like Shakespeare, Walter Scott, and Hogarth unite the two. Don't be anxious about celebrity. It will find you out sooner sitting at your easel quietly than if you made any stir. Constable never really lost that anxiety, I don't think, and this letter shows it. I've included that quote to give you the background of that anxiety and the kind of the feelings and that personality behind, you know, why this letter to Wordsworth was so important. So returning to the purpose of the letter, to thank Wordsworth for attending his lecture, what was it that motivated Wordsworth to even go? There's much to be said about Wordsworth and art, and in short, our appreciation of Wordsworth's approach to art has been skewed by certain statements he made about painting's inadequacy to appropriately convey sentiment, feeling, and nature. He was wary of any deception and any artificial rules like the Gilpinian picturesque. And of course, he'd lived through that boom in tourism of the Gilpinian kind. And he and Dorothy and Coleridge often joked very disparagingly about the kind of stream of middle-class tourists tramping by their cottage window in search of views that were picturesque. But there's a wealth of evidence to show that Wordsworth did appreciate painting, not least quotations from Hazlitt, William Hazlitt, on Wordsworth's eloquence on the subject. He had a particular interest in northern European old masters, which was the subject of Constable's lecture. And indeed, both poet and painter had numbered amongst the many illustrious visitors to merchant Carl Aders' collection of northern European paintings years before this letter was written. This subject to specific interest, knowing of Constable through others in his network and having received an invitation to attend that lecture, may have been enough motivation for that attendance. But there may have been an extra prompt. A month earlier than the writing of this letter, the 1836 Royal Academy exhibition opened, and it featured this painting by Constable, the cenotaph to the memory of Sir Joshua Reynolds. It depicts a monument erected for Reynolds 20 years after his death by Beaumont in the grounds of his home, Culloden Hall, as part of a sequence of tributes to illustrious figures. The monument was inscribed with words that Beaumont had commissioned from Wordsworth to pay tribute to Reynolds. And Constable had sketched this monument and the glade that it's in when staying with the Beaumonts over a decade before turning to paint it. Beaumont had died in 1827, but the prompt for returning to this sketch is thought to have been the plans to remove the Royal Academy from its original home at Somerset House to the National Gallery, Trafalgar Square, where, by this point, Beaumont's most prized old master pictures now hung. Its inclusion in the Royal Academy exhibition by Constable and his motivation to get it painted in time for that exhibition was therefore a tribute to his own to both Beaumont and Reynolds, and he spotlit Wordsworth's part in this tribute by reproducing the lines from the monument in the catalogue to the Royal Academy exhibition. So it's an important point of triangulation between Beaumont, Wordsworth and Constable, coming the same year that this letter was written, at a turning point in the Royal Academy's history when it moved. This was to be the last exhibition held at Somerset House, 37, it would be at the National Gallery. And although Constable couldn't know it, it was also the last Royal Academy exhibition that he would partake in. It's highly likely, though we don't know for sure, that Wordsworth visited the exhibition and saw this visual public expression of the ties that bound he and Constable. There is an added poignancy in that this is an inherently nostalgic painting, paying tribute to the man, Beaumont, whose influenced Constable's career so much, and this was to be the last painting that he exhibited in public. A month after the painting went on show, Constable gave the lecture that Wordsworth attended, and then he wrote the letter. Towards the end of it, he hints, not very subtly, I don't think, that he'd love Wordsworth to come to his last lecture, which was to be the following day. He says, "I fear I must not again flatter myself with the hope of seeing you there," full of self-deprecation. Wordsworth's attendance at the 9th of June lecture no doubt influenced the content of that final lecture. According to Beckett, much of the lectures were delivered off the cuff, but there are drafts and Leslie's comprehensive notes taken from them. But at the final lecture, the one after the one Wordsworth had attended, Constable quoted Wordsworth, and not just any Wordsworth. The lines he used were the last lines from a sonnet inspired by one of Beaumont's pictures, a picture that we don't know where it is now. But these were the very same lines that Constable had quoted in his introduction to English landscape scenery, again drawing Wordsworth directly into his intellectual projects in ways that underlined in public the ties that bound them. To round up, I want to consider the question, did Constable matter to Wordsworth? There's much evidence to suggest that the painter's respect for the poet, but did the poet care about the painter? Seamus Perry has recently argued that Wordsworth didn't. He's written that Wordsworth seems to have shown no interest in his contemporary's work. But I do think that Wordsworth's attendance at the lecture and the part he played in securing Constable's legacy beyond this point belies that. Though this letter was to be the last known point of engagement between the two men, In 1837, after Constable's death, a campaign to acquire a work by Constable for the National Gallery got underway. The Cornfield was chosen. Along with others, including scientist Michael Faraday, who'd given Constable that platform to deliver those lectures at the Royal Institution, poet Samuel Rogers and artists like William Etty, David Wilkie and Francis Chantrey, Wordsworth subscribed to the purchase of this work. He offered one guinea out of a total of 300 to be raised, writing to Leslie that he was happy to pay a tribute of respect to most so admirable an artist. This is a rather kind of polite, non-committal phrase, it's respectful, but it is evidence nonetheless of Wordsworth's interest in Constable and desire to be part of a network to preserve his memory. Peer pressure may have played a part, but Wordsworth, you know, he wasn't always, he knew his own mind. A few years later, in 1844, Constable's daughters sent Wordsworth a copy of Leslie's Memoirs of John Constable. He replied with typical formality that he was much interested in the volume and regretted that he had not, quote, "I had not the good fortune to fall in with your father till the latter part of his life when we met with mutual pleasure." He reported to them that English Landscape was a work most honourable to his genius and that it was pity that he did not prolong his stay in this beautiful country, i.e. the Lake District, that we might have had its features reflected by his pencil. Now, I do wonder whether Wordsworth knew that Constable hadn't really enjoyed his time in the Lake District and therefore not found enough material to paint an oil painting. There's quite a number of watercolours, but no significant output in oil. And I wonder too whether if Constable had done so, he would have been able to fall in with Wordsworth just that bit more, sooner in life. But as it is, Wordsworth's attendance at Constable's lecture and his subscription to the Cornfield and the letter to Constable's daughters do show that Constable was held in some esteem by Wordsworth, even if the artist did not live to see the labours of his efforts to cultivate that link, which this little piece of paper signifies, come to full fruition. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That was a fantastic start to the day. I just wanted to say to Amy that I'm really grateful to you for pointing out the lack, certainly on my part, of having seen and certainly handled any of Constable's letters. I mean, I'm primarily dealing with paintings and not even watercolours or anything. And I think that's a major omission, is the fact that when you read about, you know, we're all quoting from the letters, you often don't know where the actual physical letter is because you might want to see it, but you'd have to go around the whole of England looking for it. But the thing that was really interesting was the fact that you described the brown ink, because that had never occurred to me before. And my contact with Constable's ink is in the underdrawing to the oil paintings, which we can often see, particularly in the latter part of his career, really readily with the naked eye. So we know that there's loads and loads of this pen and ink underdrawing. And I'm often calling in people to do infrared reflectography, and we get these great surprises where we can see squaring up grids, which are in pencil, which is graphite, but we can't see the underdrawing at all. And the fact that it's brown, which often you can't really make out very obviously in the painting because it's overlaid with paint, but it had never occurred to me to look at the letters. It probably means it's iron gall ink, which is not carbon, which is why we can't see it in the infrared. So that's just like ping in my brain after nearly 40 years that you've just made that point. So I just wanted to say thank you for that.
Oh, that's great. Well, I was almost going to take that out because I thought, well, isn't it obvious to everybody? But I think it's that first job. I've worked in an organisation that was about manuscripts. It had a big collection of paintings, sketchbooks and watercolours, but primarily it was to display manuscripts. And we were always thinking about ways to make those pieces of paper behind glass come to life. And I thought that actually to start that description was important because there's so much that you take for granted in words on a piece of paper, and that removal, as you say, from the transcription is frustrating at times. Although it's not a very exciting letter, not like the one Steve showed with the illustration.
Great. Nick.
Thank you both for those wonderful papers and these really intimate moments in Constable's life that you brought to us. I wanted to ask Alexandra about this, the phrase of broken ruggedness, and if you had more to say about that in relationship to Constable's, whether watercolors or paintings from Arundel or anywhere else, because there was something very striking about, you know, the links you were drawing between that and his sort of geological eye that he was developing in that moment, right? But also that kind of dash, but, right? This brokenness of articulation and of a kind of fissure of discourse that he's trying to kind of get in between.
But what I don't understand is whether he's apologizing for past ruggedness and aiming for... But he's clearly not aiming for a new smoothness, because then he goes and does his most ruggedly, fabulously layered sketches and using watercolour, which, of course, to so many people is that crystalline, smooth surface, and changing it into as rugged as a watercolour can be. And pushing the graphite over the water mills at Fittleworth as much as he ever did on the Stour, I think. And... well, but there is this contrast, though. When he paints the water meadows, and when he does the amazing drawing of North Stoke and of Cathanger, where the landscape is very, very flat because you're dealing with water meadow, and what you've got to get at is this very intricate structure of soft, liquid landscape of reeds and the canoe. They found a canoe at North Stoke that had sort of melted almost into the mud, and they were discussing whether it should be preserved with mutton broth, etc. This liquid landscape, liquid versus ruggedness, seems to me what's coming together here. And I think it's very ambivalent, that line. I think he wants liquid and ruggedness. But I'm really happy to hear what other people...
Yeah, there's a sketch of the canoe in the letter, in the British Library.
Great.
So you know, that graphic aspect of the letters, which we've been considering, is really important. Trevor.
Thank you. This is following on from that very interesting question about the ruggedness quote, and going back also to Amy's point about paper and how we don't see the actual letters. So it's in italics, that phrase, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, it is in Beckett.
Yes, yes, yes. Do we know what that means? Do we know what Beckett means by those italics? I suppose. I'd always thought it was a quotation that Constable was saying, oh, and they think I was, you know, broken and rugged. Well, you know, watch out.
But he also underlines natural landscape just a few lines earlier. It's quite an emphatic, there's this quite emphatic sense about the whole letter where these phrases coming to mind, and even this sense of writing to Leslie, measuring up beauty and picturesque. It's like he's got all these phrases. There's, you know, these art history phrases that he's weighing up in relation to this new landscape he's looking at. So I don't know that it's from a particular source.
The critique.
Mm. But it's a really good point. Let's try and find out.
Gillian.
Yeah, just to add to that, I was thinking, fantastic talk. Thank you both so much. The rugged is such a, you know, it's a sort of, you know, trope, or it's a, you know, a cliche, isn't it? And so there's a lot of, you know, parodic references at that period by artists to the picturesque and to Gilpin. So I wonder if, you know, there's something a little bit sardonic, or he's even self-parodying, or, you know, there could be a, you know, obviously it's very rich and probably multivalent, but I'm just wondering, you know, whether there's that as well. There's a sort of embedded critique of the picturesque.
I was wondering, and this may be just too tangential, but when he's thinking of Leslie and Sussex, he's thinking of Leslie there, partly because Leslie spent so much time at Petworth. So Constable's going into a place that he completely associates with this fine, with the House of Art, with fine society that he's sort of resisting. And I wonder whether part of that, my ruggedness is in his mind, is as a kind of resistance to the Petworth circle that Leslie was so familiar with. Is that possibly in the mix?
Yeah. May I just make another comment? It also occurred to me for the first time, you know, when you were speculating about what, you know, what would Leslie say, you know, if he were walking along with me? And, you know, and I've never really thought about, you know, Leslie's transatlantic roots, you know, and Leslie grows up in America, doesn't he? Yes.
And he's just come back.
So Leslie is seeing, you know, Constable's landscapes with, you know, America, you know, somebody that you know, has grown up with that experience.
He's also looking at them with Washington Irving in mind. And he's very conscious of, interestingly, American tourism to Salisbury, right? So that's the way that's working. Interesting, Petworth, the address to Petworth is very, very carefully written, right? On the envelope, it's not dashed off at all. At the back, yeah.
Again, thanks very much for both papers, they're absolutely fascinating. Sorry to go on about the picturesqueness and the ruggedness, but given the Leslie connection, I think we need to remember that Leslie actually didn't really like Constable's late style, his broken style, his picturesque style, the way that the sort of light captures surfaces and thus the ruggedness. So, of course, in Leslie's life of Constable, he always says that the picture that he most admired or the Constable he most liked was the Hampstead studies, the kind of before the style got far too rugged. So it could partly, I think, be Constable, with all the other intimations that we've discussed and Constable sort of attacking the picturesque, I think it's also Constable apologising to Leslie, but saying, actually, sorry, mate, I am going to apologise, but no, I'm not going to change my style.
Super helpful, thank you.
Thank you. I was going to ask about Constable's best handwriting, and it's such a contrast this morning to Constable's angry handwriting to Lucas, and I just wondered if much work has been done on what sort of people, to whom did he use his best handwriting, and to tradesmen, you know, to the range of mood that he starts out on when he writes a letter. It's just so striking, it's marvellous sort of polarity for the day, and perhaps we can all keep that in mind. I'm sure he didn't use, that's handwriting you use when you're writing a Christmas thank you letter as a child, isn't it? Just incredibly polite and rather, so as you say, rather self-conscious. So I just wondered about the range and if anybody's worked on that side of him.
I hadn't, it was only in comparing and thinking about how Wordsworth, Constable had folded the letter that it occurred to me the handwriting, the letters in the binder key that I'd looked at years ago are not very legible unless you're really familiar with Constable's script. The formation of the words is very flat, it's very kind of scrawling, whereas the letter to Wordsworth, the letters are very upright and they're formed, it's much more legible. So there probably is a kind of psychoanalysis.
There's a letter from Fisher to Constable in which a word in Constable is so illegible, Fisher then transcribes it and sends it back to him and says, is this a sketch?
Yeah,
go on.
Oh, well, just that I think, Trevor, didn't you write a whole little section on the sort of visual world of the writing?
About the, you know, Constable's saying things like, well, I'm a reader, not a writer. but also my feeling was that he sometimes used his illegibility as a kind of aggression, forcing the reader to work hard, harder than necessary. It's just my impression.
Mark.
Yeah, can I just repeat? I thought they were two fantastic papers to start the day. What a way to begin. But Alex, I've got questions for you both, but because of time, I'll just ask one of you, Alex, about that. I thought the way you ended with that sketch, that late sketch of Arundel, was, and how one could reread that sketch in the light of the things that you've been discussing, was really powerful. But I was very struck still by the fact, and this again in response to your letter, about that, the power and the prominence of the tree right in the foreground, that Arundel, the castle is put well into the distance, but it's there in the distance. Then now, as you say, there is the mill that gets a really powerful prominence in the drawing, informed, no doubt, as you said, by the kind of readings of the antiquaries that you've been exploring. But then right in the foreground still is this extraordinary presence of the tree. And it'd be interesting to get your thoughts on the ways in which that kind of sets up a succession or a hierarchy of priorities or visual priorities from front to back.
Yeah, beautiful, thank you. And the beech trees of those hangars are really you know, were sort of famously ancient around Offham Hangar. I don't know any sketches that Constable did during that period, just of sort of tree portraits, as it were. And in fact, that whole sort of genre of the tree portrait that he would have known through Cooper. I'm sort of interested in, you know, Cooper's Yardley Oak and that sort of sense of what is a tree by itself and what is its life and so on. But for Constable, it's so much about the tree and its setting and the relationship between tree and building and the way the castle becomes clothed and softened, the sort of excrescence of this ugly castle becomes coherent because of the hangers enfolding it somehow. Yeah.
I think Tim may have written in your Salisbury book, Tim, but there's something in a letter the Constable writes to Fisher, probably in Salisbury, where he characterises different trees in the grounds of Salisbury Cathedral. Mm. So he had done that kind of characterisation of individual trees, but yeah, not Arundel.
Okay, when you word search the future digital edition of the correspondence, you find there is another dictatorial Beaumont in the correspondence. This is Beaumont, the village postman in East Burgold, who rings his bell, and Constable has to dash off and finish his letters. So we'll finish there. The bell for coffee is rung. Thank you very much for two wonderful papers.